Straight ahead on Entrepreneur, Ice Cube talks about his latest movie and being a self-starter in the film and music world.
As a entertainer, you know what I mean? I think you gotta find your own voice to really be a unique talent, you know?
And Nick Cannon sits down with the editor of Entrepreneur.com to talk about what else? Entertainment and business. And we hear from the master motivation expert, Joe DeSana, with his Spartan Up series, plus a little more inspiration.
It's crazy to me. You think about like how many families, you know, that have become successful. It all started with like your great grandparents or father, mother that immigrated here.
Those stories and a Shark Tank star gives us his good advice. Entrepreneur starts right now. Hi, I'm Lance Smith, in for Patricia Wu this week. As always, we start with our celebrity entrepreneurs. Now, they say you should never be the same person in your 40s as you were in your 20s. Well, that's especially true for O'Shea Jackson, known to the world as Ice Cube. Cube shot to fame in the 80s as gangster rapper in N.W.A. and has gone on to become a wildly successful producer, actor, filmmaker, and entrepreneur. The road wasn't always smooth out of South Central L.A., so how did Ice Cube find his voice as an entertainer and entrepreneur? Our correspondent Scott Carty found out.
I'm gonna fight you.
I'm sorry, what?
Parking lot. After school. It's on.
Teachers don't fight.
I want everybody to see this.
You get to go one-on-one with Charlie Day, who is one of the funniest people, I think, in Hollywood.
Sure.
Good thing, I mean, a little hint for fans, they need to make sure to stick around to the end of the movie.
Because
we get to see some fun stuff. But talk about working with him and just the banter you guys had.
Well, Charlie, you know, I've been wanting to work with him, you know, ever since I seen him, you know, come on the scene. Then I looked at Horrible Bosses, and I was like, man, me and this dude ever get in a movie together, we're gonna knock it out the park. And I actually was wanting him to be in Ride Along too, but it didn't work out. And then this script came along and it was perfect. And I just think he's extremely talented as far as coming up with his own style of comedy. You know, and I just think he's brilliant at, you know, playing the guy that you know, but also being able to make you laugh without, you know, being over the top silly.
Yeah.
You know, it's
he doesn't force it.
No, not at all.
It's genuine.
And it's just, it's natural flow, and he got his own lane, and it's great.
Hashtag teacher fight. Who else knows about this?
I don't need to be liked. I need to educate.
I think that a lot of that is about finding your own voice. And, you know, you're a massive entrepreneur and built a tremendous business. Talk about finding your own voice as a businessman.
Well, you know, as a entertainer, you know what I mean? I think you gotta find your own voice to really be a unique talent. You know, we love the unique voices of our day, you know, from, you know, Humphrey Bogart to Muhammad Ali. You know, you have to be unique. And I've always tried to be, you know, myself and not, you know, be influenced by too many other entertainers or what they're doing, and really just stay in my own lane and concentrate on my crowd and what I'm doing. And they've rewarded me with a lot of longevity and success. And, you know, we're doing other things, you know, with Q-Vision and growing the company. And it's just, you know, sky's the limit.
The rewards and the longevity have been incredible, but there have had to have been some moments, though, where there were real challenges. How do you get through challenging times?
Oh man, faith. You know, have faith in not only faith in God, but faith in your own talent, and faith in doing everything you can to make it happen. You know, you can do anything you want to in this world. All you got to do is do what it takes. And you know, I pride myself on stepping up to the challenge and then doing what it takes to get over that hump.
It's awesome. Good to see you.
All right.
Thanks a lot, man.
I just don't know the first thing about fighting.
Make a fist.
Are you serious? This is the 1700?
Fist Fight is in theaters now. And here's a fun fact. Ice Cube made the jump from music to movies when an intern at the Arsenio Hall show approached him and introduced himself as an aspiring filmmaker who wanted to work with him. That intern was John Singleton, now acclaimed director, producer, and screenwriter in the movie Boys in the Hood.
Black food can get shot all the time. Trying to show how hard they are. Ignorant.
Aw, fool, shut up.
Gabrielle Union is a true Hollywood triple threat. Actress, activist, and entrepreneur. She's long fought against prevailing beauty standards, so now she's combining her passions for social justice and beauty by launching her own hair care line. Gabby is launching Flawless March 1st with the company behind Macadamia Natural Oil. Products include everything from shampoo to blowout creams and protection sprays. Gabby says her motive is simple. She wants to help empower women, especially those with natural hair, who are underrepresented in the market. She says, quote, "A lot of people think if you wear extensions or weaves, you're full of self-hatred. And if you wear natural styles, your sense of self and culture is high. But each person has their own hair journey." So Gabby is making sure women have quality products at affordable prices, no matter the style they choose to rock. We say, bring it on. And Gabby is on to something, at least according to a desperate housewife. Actress slash social media entrepreneur Eva Longoria says a social mission must be a part of your company's DNA if you want to succeed. She founded the Eva Longoria Foundation to help Latinas build better futures for themselves through education and entrepreneurship. And while serving as a judge and mentor at a business competition dubbed The Venture, which provides funding to social entrepreneur newbies with the best ideas for impacting the world, Eva dispersed more tips for aspiring entrepreneurs. She says, quote, "Innovation comes from need, so always look at obstacles as opportunities. Think local, impact global. The bigger picture will help foster success. And don't just know your purpose, but know why it's your purpose. That understanding will help keep you in business." From a desperate housewife to a real housewife who had to not only think like a man to grow her business empire, but outsmart them. Bethany Frankel, breakout star of The Real Housewives of New York City, launched her multi-million dollar business with a personal desire for a cocktail minus all the guilt. And voila, Skinny Girl was born in 2009 and quickly became one of the best-selling low-calorie alcohol lines of all time. Bethany says she hit many roadblocks in the beginning, especially because the liquor business is still predominantly run by males. So she has this advice for aspiring female entrepreneurs.
Not to discuss the glass ceiling and how much more money everybody else gets paid than us, and being a woman and woe is me, be better than the men. You'll never get that same drive and spirit than the beginning when you have nothing and you know you have a good idea.
In 2011, Bethany sold the Skinny Girl margarita brand to the liquor conglomerate Beam Suntory, the maker of Jim Beam, but still gets a cut of the sales. The sale made Frankel rich and helped her usher in an era in food marketing inspiring female-focused innovations like Skinny Pop, Skinny Pizza, and the Skinny Flavored Latte. One man on top of his game is Nick Cannon. He makes music, TV shows, runs companies, and spearheads philanthropic initiatives. The only thing that Nick doesn't seem to do is sleep. Entrepreneur.com's editorial director Dan Bova sat down with Cannon, who says he's fueled by an untamable entrepreneurial spirit passed down from his father.
A great definition of an entrepreneur is someone who jumps off a building and on the way down figures out how to land.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
right,
it's that
right.
Idea of just like, I'm gonna make it happen. And
yeah.
I'm gonna jump out there with as much faith as possible to invest in myself and therefore, you know, have as many successful business ventures as possible.
So you've been incredibly successful over the years. Have there been moments where you were terrified that this one thing wasn't gonna work out?
Oh, plenty of times.
Okay.
So many times, because again, like I said, my number one investment is myself and my own projects and my own creativity. And a lot of times, I mean, I'll tell you, like, one of the things that's probably one of my most successful creative endeavors to date, wilding out, nobody believed in it.
Mm.
And I actually put up my own money early on to shoot the pilot because MTV didn't understand what I was trying to do. Like, just even my agents, my managers, they're like, what are you doing? It's a waste of time.
Right.
It was a lot of money, too. Like, I rented out a comedy club, had to pay all the comedians.
Okay.
Like, all the crew and everything.
Right.
And it was just a passion project that I just knew. I was like, yo, there's something here.
Okay.
Cut to, you know, over 100 episodes later, later, some really successful people and a solid brand.
So is there ever a moment during that shooting of that first pilot where you look out and you're like, what did I just do?
especially when it's all wrapped and said and done, you're like, oh, or when you that first pitch meeting, you're like, all right, I hope you can understand what I've put together.
Right,
I mean, to this day, I just financed a film that I started and produced, wrote in Jamaica. And everybody again was like, man, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? And I just felt like I really needed to tell the story of that subculture and just the beautiful energy in Jamaica. And, you know, luckily we sold it. But when you go to those film festivals, we debuted at the Toronto Film Festival.
Oh, wow.
And we're still in film festivals. We'll be in the Santa Barbara Film Festival the end of this weekend, Pan-African Film Festival in the upcoming days. So, but you go to these festivals to hopefully someone buys your film.
Yeah.
And all these bidding wars and stuff. And it's like, yo, I just spent X amount of dollars. You know what I mean? The kids' college funds or the,
X is a big number
sometimes. Yeah, like so. But nah, it all pays off, man. And that's the beauty of being an entrepreneur is like taking those risks. And you got to be fearless out here if you really want to be successful. You know, I don't know anyone that has become successful without taking risks.
Coming up on Entrepreneur, we sit down with best-selling author and blogger Glennon Doyle Melton about how to share your story with the world, building your brand, plus later.
If you had unlimited money, what would you do? What would you love to do? What would be your ideal situation and how do you make it happen?
What would I do to find that passion? What would it truly take? If I had everything in the world, what would I truly do in life?
When she asked me that, it was a surprise to me because out came, I want to make hats, right? And I just taken this class, I just make a couple hats at that point for her, for friends, whatever.
But that just came out.
Yeah, I was like, hats, I want to make hats. And she was like, then go make hats. So I literally got on a plane, I think the next day, which I think I was supposed to leave, but flew out. And I had hired two people off Craigslist, got folding tables and chairs, and I was like, I'm doing this. I don't know how, but I'm doing this. And set up my apartment, moved the furniture from a living room to a bedroom, and set up a hat factory in my apartment.
And we jump into the Shark Tank with Damon John. Those stories when Entrepreneur comes right back.
This is you. This is your circle. They're bigger than you in life, in money, in income, in lifestyle. You're not. You're the green one. But if you have a circle that out earns you or out succeeds you, you're eventually going to be there. It's a formula. This is not an accidental thing. This is why you'll notice some of the people that don't achieve success, they always want people smaller than them around them because it makes them feel bigger. The people that you meet are super successful, they always put themselves around situations where people are bigger than them because it's the next platform, next level they're getting to. Next one, their mind never stops. Let me explain what I mean by the mind never stops. Oh, you know what? What if this happens? And what if I could have this life? What if I talk to this person? What if I go over here? What if we figure this out? They're in bed and they're still thinking, you know what? Let me see, we should do this. And you know, earlier we were talking about this thing 3 hours ago. Yes, I was thinking about it. I think we need to do this. And what if we did this? Because this could happen. Your mind just never stops, like a beautiful mind.
The best piece of business advice I've been given is adapt or die. You know, in life and in business, there's a lot of changes. In public relations especially, there's always new forms of communication, whether it's social media or blogs or influencers, there's always something new. So either we adapt with that change or we die as an agency. So that's always been my mindset, both in business and in life.
Patience can be a weapon. And if you slow down just a little bit, it gives you enormous advantages. Let things come to you. Prompt them in a way so that they will come to you, but let them come to you. A successful negotiator understands that it's got to be a collaborative process, even when the person we're negotiating with might not look at it as a collaborative process. Successful negotiators also, they get their game plan down, and then they stick to it, and they're not rattled by changes or unexpected surprises. Actually, surprises are only unexpected if you're afraid of them. If you welcome surprises, they usually bring opportunities.
There is power in storytelling, which is why many entrepreneurs, executives, and brand representatives wonder how to share their personal stories effectively. They may not be sure of when, where, why, and what to share. How much transparency, authenticity, and vulnerability is too much? Host and founder of ThePursuit.tv, Kelsey Humphreys, sat down with blogger and New York Times best-selling author Glennon Doyle Melton on her keys to best share your story with the world.
So then you start to write and email your friends, which I love. But first, how did you just decide, okay, I'm going to go to my closet every morning, you know, and just pour out whatever comes to mind?
Yeah, so I mean, part of my recovery from addiction is this idea of living shame-free. Like, shame is the kiss of death, okay? It's not like the pain of life that takes us out of the game. It's the shame about the pain, right? Mm-hmm. That's what keeps us in hiding. That's what keeps us secretive, and secrets kill us. So I knew that to stay sane and sober, I needed to have a place to be real. Mm-hmm. Okay, because we have these representatives that we have to send out into the world, and they're allowed to say like five things, like the weather and your scarf and whatever the hell. And that's fine, but you like die inside because there's this real you behind you, like suffocating, dying to come out. So like when your representative says, I'm fine, your real self is back there going, but I'm not fine. I'm really lonely and I'm a little angry and help. So I knew I had to find a place to let that real self out. One day I woke up and went into my closet because I didn't have any other rooms in my house to be alone, and just started typing. And it was like that real self just popped out onto the computer screen. Okay. Mm-hmm. And looking at my words on a white piece of paper looked more to me like looking into a mirror than I've ever felt actually looking into a mirror. Because like, this is my representative. Mm-hmm. Right? That's why I have like 12 pounds of makeup on, and my hair is not actually this color. I mean, I can't figure out how to not be my my real self in person yet. That's like the final frontier.
We're working towards it.
Right. But in writing, that was my real self, and it was this moment of, oh, there she is. Mm. There she is. Like, that's the real me. And so I just wanted to keep coming back to that over and over again. So yeah, I used to send my thoughts. I'd wake up early in the morning. I promised myself that I would write for an hour and a half every morning. So I got up at like 4:30, because it had to be before the kids were awake. Because the second my people wake up, I forget everything that I know. I just can't. You know, because then you go into role mode if you're a woman. Mm-hmm. Like, here I'm a wife, I'm a mother, I'm a blah, blah, blah. But in those early morning hours, I was no roles. I was just a soul. Mm. You know, that's when I came out. So I used to send my thoughts to my friends every morning. And my poor friends. I did that for so long. And they finally, I think it was my friend Joanna who ended up designing the cover of the book. But I used to send my thoughts to them every morning and then just wait for their response, right? They were at work, okay? And then if they didn't write me back, I'd write to them again and be like, so did you get a chance to read my thoughts about the universe? How do you feel? And so finally, Joanna sent me directions to how to start a blog. Because she was like, this is what people do so they can still have friends. We don't want to write back to you every day.
Yeah.
So then I started Mama's Diary.
We've all had our valleys in life, but some of us go much deeper in the valley than others. And it's those people who make it back that become figures of inspiration. The master motivator, Spartan Race founder, and CEO Joe DeSana found just the man, and he takes you through his journey.
All right, we are here for Spartan Up Podcast with Kelly Starrett of Mobility Wad. He's the owner, founder, co-founder, along with your wife. And surprisingly to me, because he's a big guy, he's also an endurance athlete. I mean, you're into whitewater rafting, long distances. You're about to do some crazy race with your wife.
The Molokai. You know what's interesting? We're in this. I just wanted to just talk about endurance. Can you just, like, you're going to hold that kettlebell the entire thing.
Yeah, and I'm thinking like a 3 or 4 hour interview.
Oh, sounds good to me. What you're going to see, though, is watch his shoulders decay into internal rotation. It's going to be great. You know, we're living in this interesting age where the generalist is back. You know, I think you guys have done such a good job with Spartan Race, saying, oh, you have a big set of lungs, but you don't know how to climb. And you actually don't know how to suffer. You know how to be uncomfortable. You know how to be scared. So how do we create that? I think the greater conversation in the world right now is, what's the programming look like to create a ready state so people are pretty good to go? I mean, like, really good to go. Not means
ready,
like
ready state so that, like, if there was an earthquake, they could jump off the couch.
Oh, no. I think, how about ready state is like, hey, we're going to go hike the Grand Canyon this weekend. You with us? Sure. Hey, you're going to move this piano for the next 20 minutes. I mean, like that, like a legit ready state. Oh, hey, we're going to do a week-long heli ski race or heli, you know, I mean, how do we create it so that you also don't get injured? Unless, you know, someone tackles you, what does that look like? And also, how do you create skills so you can keep learning new skills?
Could you be in a ready state given today's technology? In other words, I end up sitting on a computer 6 hours, 7 hours a day.
Are you on the computer or are you sitting on the computer?
Well, I'm not sitting on, I'm sitting down and typing, yes. I'm not standing.
That's what I mean. So yeah. So here's the issue is that I think we're seeing, we call this adaptation error. Right. Right now, we got interested in sitting, for example, because we noticed that some of the Division I universities we're working with were seeing the same sequela of problems. Same thing we saw in our tactical athletes. Right. Short anterior hip, posture like this. Wonder why our arms don't go over our head. Why we're having back problems, extension problems. Why we're just losing performance. And when we started doing some informal surveys, we found out those guys were sitting 12 to 14 hours a day.
So I'm on a crusade to get rid of the couch. You're beyond that. You want any sitting gone.
Well, you know, I think let's sit on the ground. So, you know, in cultures that toilet on the ground, sleep on the ground, people don't fall. There's like zero fall risk. So, I mean, that's, you know, they can get up off the ground. The number one reason you end up in a nursing home is you can't get up off the ground. But if you're always on the ground,
you're not gonna fall.
You don't lose it. Right. Like your hip range of motion doesn't go away. We think, I was having this conversation with our friend Mark Bell, who is a powerlifter, really good powerlifter. And I was like, hey, Mark, here's the problem. You haven't actually taken your hip to full range of motion in maybe 2 months. And he's like, what do you mean? I'm like, well, you sit at the edge of the bed, 90, right? Toilet, 90, chair, 90, car, 90, you squat to 90. I'm like, when's the last time you actually did your whole, like, hip in the full range? If we take that to the average person, they basically have these huge movement windows and they're just looking out this little tiny corner and then the window just gets opaque.
Great analogy. I love it. I mean, I didn't even know we were going here and I love it. I thought I was walking into a regular CrossFit gym. You're awesome.
Dude.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Spartan Up has been sponsored by Organiche Boosters. Watch Joe right here every week or check out his podcast at spartan.com/podcast. Next on Entrepreneur, we're talking food and advice. We take you into the kitchen with chef star Mario Batali, and later.
I would say opportunities that come around every day, I would put 3 to 5 years in it. Long-term opportunities that you're thinking about, I would say 10 years.
We'll be right back. You've spent 2 years getting your new restaurant ready to open, but then disaster strikes right before the big moment. This is the story brought to you by Staples of entrepreneur restaurant owners Mike Price and Joey Campanero. Proof that despite obstacles, there's almost always a way to keep moving forward.
At first, I was definitely feeling angry and frustrated. The fact that we had spent almost 2 years by the time we had executed the lease and built the space and done all of our paperwork and got everything together and we were ready to open a restaurant and then found out that there was this huge snafu. My name is Mike Price. I'm the chef and co-owner of The Clam.
My name is Chef Joey Campanero, and I'm a co-owner of The Clam. The Clam is the third of our seasonal Mediterranean restaurants located here in Greenwich Village. There are thousands of problems that can happen when anyone's opening up any type of business, let alone a restaurant. This being our third restaurant that we opened together, we thought maybe we knew it all and we were gonna knock this one out of the park. We're excited, we have our menu, we have our staff in place, and Con Ed doesn't let us open because they won't turn on our gas because they found out that the pipe was too small. Instead of throwing in the towel, we barreled down and we looked for a solution.
We modified our menu where we didn't want the customer to notice that we had modified it. We took some items off that were supposed to be grilled and made them sauteed. We also modified the equipment. We needed to buy electrical equipment, and we had extension cords running all over the kitchen to the basement to sustain the electrical load. And eventually, after 4 months, Con Ed dug up the street, gave us the right size pipe, and we were able to get full gas. There was definitely some frustration and anger. But at the end of the day, after we got past that, we definitely relied on each other to move forward and come together. And at the end, I think what ended up happening is everybody felt very empowered. The fact that we were ready to open a restaurant with a certain menu in a certain way, under a certain mindset, and then to have that kind of turned upside down, but then persevere and turn that losing hand into a winning hand, I think is a testament to both of us.
Quite a turnaround. Staples is celebrating small businesses just like The Clam that have overcome obstacles and found success. For more stories like this, go to entrepreneur.com.
What was the turning point in Italy where you realized this is my goal, this is my path, and I'm going to do big things in this competitive restaurant industry?
Well, it was that was less about the competition and the intensity. That was more about learning the actual background of technique and style. So I learned as much in Italy how to make stuff, but I also learned how simple plates had to be and how to remove those extraneous ingredients.
Did you have any doubt about your move from leaving the Four Seasons restaurant to making it out on your own in a different country? Did you have doubt, and how did you overcome it?
I have, for all of my life, been a victim of something we call delusional optimism. So I have yet to face too many doubts. There are moments when it's tough and you just put your head down and make sure that you do your work. That's effectively how you get rid of all of the problems in your world. Just put your head down and do what you know how to do it. Do it best. Embellish it. Flourish. And survive.
In addition to running several restaurants as well as publishing cookbooks, it seems like the celebrity chef also has to be a digital chef nowadays. Could you discuss what Mario is up to in that field?
Well, not everyone has to be everything. I'm just lucky enough that I have a group big enough and smart enough team that enables me to do all the things that I want. So I'll dabble in the Twitter world or in the Instagram world and have somebody take care of the Facebook stuff for me. But at the end of the day, you can't be it all. So choose the things that you're really good at and hire people to help you do the other things.
When it comes to mealtime, there are literally thousands of options. But one thing that probably most of us can agree on is pizza is our favorite. But pizza isn't always the healthiest option. Until now, Organizza is changing the game. Sean from Serenata is here to tell us more. Hi, Sean.
Hi, Deanne. Yes, we've actually been in the organic food business for over 30 years with organic partners worldwide.
Okay, Sean, so I'm noticing two brands here. We have Rustic Crust and Organizza. So are these two different companies, or how does this work?
Well, we actually created a strategic partnership with Rustic Crust, which is an all-natural crust pizza company. Together, we're trying to create the world's healthier pizza.
Okay, so I can't stop looking at this pizza crust. It looks so delicious, and the packaging is just perfect. So tell me a little bit more about Rustic Crust and the origins of the company.
Well, Rustic Crust was actually founded by Russ Sterl, who wanted to have a traditional but much healthier version of pizza innovations.
Okay, so when I order pizza from just a normal pizza place, the toppings are kind of same old, boring, nothing exciting. But it looks like Organita has a lot of options available.
Yes, we have a number of healthy options available for our consumers. Things like jalapeno crushed peppers, habanero, and chipotle crushed as well.
Next on Entrepreneur.
They have a day job and they plan on putting in 7 hours a week onto this side hustle job idea concept. You know, but make sure that compounds, and over the year, how much time will you put into it?
We'll be right back. Pharrell's spreading happy vibes beyond just his music with Bionic Yarn, a company that creates high-performance yarn and fabric from recycled plastic. So far, Bionic Yarn has teamed up with some of the biggest names in the fashion business, including Adidas, Timberland, Topshop, and Gap, to create upcycled clothing collections. The company also recently collaborated with G-Star Raw and Parlay for the Oceans to transform recovered plastic from shorelines into an entire denim collection. He's known around the world as an investor on the hit television show Shark Tank, but Daymond John is, of course, much more. Whether it's running his company, writing a book, or working with a startup, he's an entrepreneur always in motion. Behind the Brand founder and host Brian Elliott sat down with John to discuss his success, failures, and what he thinks is the best formula for pitching ideas.
We're all born thinking like entrepreneurs. Families and friends convince you not to be an entrepreneur. True entrepreneurs will just keep figuring it out. If you pull up your car outside of a mall, you open your trunk and you were selling something for a dollar and you sold 50 of them in 3 minutes, you close that trunk, you call me.
Yeah.
Because we're gonna sell those things out of every single mall, city, state, country. We're even gonna sell them on Mars if we can sell them that quick.
Hi, I'm Brian Elliott. Welcome to another edition of Behind the Brand. Today I'm here with entrepreneur Daymond John. Daymond, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
How long do you give a good idea before you kind of cut bait? I mean, you know it's a viable thing. Maybe you're passionate about it, but how long do you give it before you're just like, this isn't working, we gotta give up and move on?
If it's going from an incubation stage, it can take 5-10 years because you start thinking about it year one, and year two and year three, you still are thinking about it and you're going, yeah, all right, this hasn't just gone away. This needs to happen.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you start to learn the business with it and it can take 10 years.
Yeah.
If it's an opportunity where you're investing, it probably is a 3-year deal where you go, we've done everything, or I'm not interested in learning any more of this. It's creating bigger challenges. I'm losing more in other places that I have already created. So I would say opportunities that come around every day, I would put 3 to 5 years in it. Long-term opportunities that you're thinking about, I would say 10 years.
So that works for you. You've got resources. So some of the people that are watching this show, you know, they've got this startup. They're just bootstrapping. What advice would you give to them about how long to give a worthy project before they give up? I mean, I think it's something everyone struggles with.
Yeah, and that's a big challenge. So I would say for them to have milestones and for them to set their goals. So if there's somebody that, you know, they have a day job and they plan on putting in 7 hours a week onto this side hustle job idea concept, you know, make sure that compounds, and over the year, how much time will you put into it? And at what stage would you like to see? Would you like to see the business grow from $1,000 a week to 5 or 10? But make sure it's affordable steps that you and goals that you feel you can hit. And then you'll realize if you're willing to put 1 year, 2 years, or 10 years into it. Some people just want to do it because they want to be an entrepreneur and they want to change the world and they just want to see things change. They don't have to make money.
That's what I was going to ask you. So what are some of those business milestones that you would recommend? So obviously revenue is great. You know, when you've got sales and you've got demand and you're moving product, that's great. But maybe talk about some of those tougher to measure metrics for those people who are still hanging on.
The tougher to measure metrics are basically, I'm making $50,000 a year. If I put 2-3 hours of work and time into this a week, at the end of the year, will I make a certain amount of money, or at the end of the year, will I change somebody's life? It all depends on what are you in it for? Because many entrepreneurs are into things for social reasons as well. So you just really have to put a metric on what are you looking for. At the end of the day, you're the customer.
Yeah.
What are you gonna get out of it?
What mistakes have you made? I wanna know, not from the perspective of, you know, as a confessional, but more of, you know, what's the hindsight? What did you learn?
What mistakes I made? We don't have enough time to go over them.
Give me
a
couple.
I'm gonna go over a couple. Yeah. I learned that, you know, we thought we were cool because FUBU was super fiery hot and we understood a lifestyle, so we thought that naturally we can go out and make an album, and we did. not us singing, I'm talking about artists that we worked with, because we already dressed all the artists, we already knew all the artists, right? We were on half the video set, so creatively we understood it. But guess what? We didn't know the business behind it, so yeah, we sold 500,000 units of the album, but it cost us $5 million to make the album because we didn't know any better. Yeah. I learned at that time that, you know, there's no shortcuts. That's it. We didn't hire a record executive. We didn't know our numbers. We didn't look at our numbers. We were spending money like drunken sailors. we were getting caught up. What was the reason we were doing it? Did we get exposure? Yes. But from the business model, we died, right? So, you know, I learned that mistake. I learned that unless we have goals set, you don't know what you're doing. You know, I learned that when money came into the company, I would give friends, you know, here's a $100,000 raise, here's a $200,000 raise. Yeah. I learned that if you don't have a set formula in your company and you're doing $10 million of business and your, let's say your salaries are $1 million, if you go off giving everybody money, before you know it, next year, your salaries are $2.5 million, you're only doing $12 million in business. Yeah. I've learned to come up with a formula. Give people anywhere from 5% to 10% raise. You know that if your salaries are $1 million, you know next year it's $1 million plus an average of 7.5%. Yeah. I learned all these things.
Kind of standardizing, man.
Just standardizing and coming up with formulas, you know, and learning sometimes when to quit.
Yeah.
You know, when to write it off. We're not good at this, you know?
If you had unlimited money, what would you do? What would you love to do? What would be your ideal situation and how do you make it happen?
We're gonna meet with Satya Twaina. This girl is so inspiring. She literally came to New York with no money, not figuring out what she was gonna do, had to figure out how to get an apartment, and now she owns the only hat factory in all of New York City, and had to figure out her passion, and it led to hats. It led to her passion for what those hats meant and how it changed us and how it made people feel. And you know what? During that time, one of the most devastating moments happened to her in her life.
So I took a class at FIT, a night class, started at 7, we'd go to 10, like a couple of weeks, so 12 weeks, and it wasn't love at first sight. It wasn't like, oh my god, I love this, this is amazing, this is going to be my whole life. It was kind of like, it's cool. But what happened next was insane. My mom was diagnosed with breast cancer maybe 2 weeks after this class ended, and life has a funny way of showing you things that you're not even open to. Like, if you would have told me 10 years ago that I'd be a hat maker owning a hat factory in New York City, I would have said crazy.
There's constant times where you think to yourself, should I give up? Should I stop? How do I keep going? You know what I mean? Like, am I gonna be able to continue? But you have to just believe. And the more that you believe in yourself, the more that things will manifest.
My parents got divorced 6 months before.
Wow.
Then my mom was diagnosed with cancer.
Wow.
And it really was like it was like the biggest internal earthquake, because it was like, what does this mean? Who am I? What does marriage look like? What does partnership look like? What does my life look like as a child of like really amazing parents who've gotten divorced? Like, what does this all mean?
Yeah.
Right? And so, but it was good, because I think that, you know, when you crack open, when you're forced to crack, you actually are able to see what's inside and what you desire. Because when you're limitless, you can crave anything, right? And being limitless sometimes means you're at the bottom. And I think most of my incredible moments in life have been from being what I've considered in my life rock bottom.
Yeah.
Whether it's financial,
forced to have that crack open.
Yeah, and then forced to be like, well, so what do I want to do?
Yeah.
What's gonna make me happy? Started making my mom hats and sent them to her. She wore them when she was bald, and just kind of was like, I love this. It ended up being a real low moment in my life. I was with my mom, who was going through chemo treatment, and of course, like, sitting there complaining to somebody who's lost her hair, has gained 50 pounds, is like battling to save her life, and I'm like, Mom, my life is falling apart. And there's something amazing that happens with people who have cancer. It's like, they don't give a
It's in those moments you're completely fearless. You know, and you find out what really matters in life.
But she was like in such a place of surrender while going through chemo and radiation. She's like, look, I might die, but I have an amazing life. I have amazing kids. Like, I've got to experience this amazing, amazing thing, right? This amazing game. And so I'm sitting with her, I'm complaining about like my. And so she was like, you need to surrender. And then she asked me like a question that now I ask myself all the time. And she not only did it once, she now has done it twice for me in a place, and it's always in her bed and we're cuddly. And she said, if you had no limits, if you had no, if you had a limitless amount of money.
Yeah, we should ask them this question.
Yeah, like if you had unlimited money, what would you do? What would you love to do? What would be your ideal situation and how do you make it happen?
What would I do to find that passion? What would it truly take if I had everything in the world? What would I truly do in life?
When she asked me that, it was like, it was a surprise to me because out came, I want to make hats, right? And I just taken this class. I just make a couple hats at that point for her, for friends, whatever.
But that just came out.
Yeah, I was like, hats. I want to make hats.
Straight ahead, we sit down with Oscar-winning actress Emma Stone to talk about how to deal with a personal slump. Entrepreneur, we'll be right back. Charbroil Grill, known for awesome barbecue, is now introducing a wide series of organic options of rubs and seasonings. Charbroil Grill has a long legacy of innovation, and we honor that legacy with the new Charbroil Organics brand. Also, if you're looking for info on that perfect cut of meat, check out ButcherShops.org, a tribute to the Butcher Shops of America and the new trend of butcher shops being created everywhere. Now, if you pick out that perfect choice of meat, it's time to pick out that perfect grill. Charbroil has created a whole new series of innovative barbecue grills now available at retailers nationwide, as well as throughout Canada. No two grillers are alike. Same goes for grills. No matter who you are or how you cook, there's a Charbroil with your name on it. For more info, go to charbroil.com.
Charbroil's new Signature Series convective gas grills deliver reduced flare-ups, easy cleanup, and superior cooking performance with new firebox technology. Take a look inside to see the new innovative design. New high-efficiency partitions keep heat focused where it should be, on your food. The stainless steel partitions reflect heat straight toward the cooking grates, resulting in a more even and efficient cook. Our Signature Series grill preheats faster than the competition. No hot or cold spots, you get even heat across the grill. And the high-efficiency partitions allow for better zonal control. This improves cooking performance and decreases fuel consumption. High searing heats can be dedicated to your steaks in one zone while you slow roast your veggies in another. Charbroil Signature Series convective gas grills deliver premium features for outdoor grilling heroes.
Serenata Brands was founded to be the retail arm of a company that is the largest wholesale manufacturer of organic herbs and spices. Thus, we were in a great position to team up with Charbroil to be able to provide their all-organic line of seasonings and rubs. Charbroil is an iconic grilling brand, so of course everything here was designed with grilling in mind. That being said, you can also use it in other cooking, like skillet, for example. We like to skillet or grill it. That's where the name comes from. So, we have a Nebraska Prime steak seasoning, sweet lemon pepper, we have organic salmon and fish seasoning and rub, we have a vegetable seasoning, we have garlic pepper, we have mesquite barbecue. So these will go great on all of these meats that we have over here. Shrimp platter, we have a turkey, we have some trout, ideal for the salmon and fish. We have some ribs, and we have some beef cuts right here. This would be great with either the mesquite or with the Nebraska prime steak seasoning. So as a team, Charbroil and ourselves are going to be hitting several different markets. The first is hardware stores, sports stores, anywhere where people are going to be buying grills, you're going to be able to find these seasonings. We're also going to be hitting supermarkets, natural grocery retailers, etc. So look very soon, because we're going to be expanding this product lineup quickly with some really gourmet seasoning and rubs utilizing unique ingredients. So we have a lot coming, and we're really excited about it. So look for us in the future, because next time I'm going to show you guys how to use these seasoning and rubs on some meat before we grill it, and it's going to be delicious.
We all face a time in our life, business, personal, or both, where we face challenges and doubts. We call them mental emergencies.
Our correspondent Scott Carty sat down with Oscar-winning actress Emma Stone to talk about what she does to push a slump.
People can look at you and think that you're doing so well. Do you ever feel like you're in any sort of a slump or a downtime? And if you do, how do you get through those times?
Yeah, I certainly feel that way. I feel that way today.
Is it me?
I think
me?
That's always it. No, it's not you. I think that that's a kind of an ever, you know, depends on your energy levels or mm-hmm. on your, there's so many things. But I guess if you mean like a career slump or downtime, I think you just keep your head down and you keep your nose to the grindstone and you just keep working. If you just keep working, it's, you know, if you just keep create, which I don't even mean because you're gonna be fired from a job and mm-hmm. so then you're like, how do you just keep working? But I think it's creating.
Yeah.
Creating and finding ideas and knowing that eventually everything changes. This too shall pass. So even the times of, you know, down will pass.
That'll do it for us at Entrepreneur. To watch any part of our show or check out thousands of articles that will motivate you, go to entrepreneur.com. Thanks for watching.
Talk about finding your own voice as a businessman.
Well, you know, as a entertainer, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? I think you gotta find your own voice to really be a unique talent. You know, we love the unique voices of of our day, you know, from, you know, Humphrey Bogart to Muhammad Ali.